Welcome. So when I heard we were going to be in San Antonio this year, I was like, we've got to get San Antonio music here that I've been learning about for the about past 5 to 6 years. We started coming down and learning about Chicano soul music on the West Side, started filming these reunion concerts and stuff, and I've just been blown away with the music. So we put together a panel this morning to talk about San Antonio music and some El Paso music. So we're celebrating Mexican-American music here. I'm not going to get into a lot of lengthy introductions here because we're short on time, and these guys have a lot of great information. The order, we're going to start with Ruben Cubillos this morning, and he's going to talk about his artwork of making Tejano music. I mean, kind of transformed the industry with these album jackets. It's just amazing. And then we're going to go into Henry Peña over here and Chris Varelas and Ray Cabello talking about music here in San Antonio. And we'll wind up with Benny Bustillos over here. And he's going to talk about his documentary that he's working on music out of El Paso. And he's going to show us a clip of El Pasoul, the documentary that he's working on. So we're going to begin with Mr. Benny, not with Benny this morning, but with Ruben Cubillos. So Ruben, please, you'll come up here and give us an introduction.
Hello, testing, is this thing on? Hello?
Yes.
Hello? Oh, there you go. Welcome everybody to San Antonio. Go Spurs, go. We saw you guys over there honking last night, you know, getting the cab and yeah. Thank you for joining us. I gotta tell you, it's been a privilege to have worked in the music business, and I'm still working at it. It's just not gone from my sights, nor it ever will be. Retirement's not a word in my vocabulary. And I think once you see some of the things that I have been privileged to have touched and worked on and contributed to this genre of music, of Mexican-American music called Tejano music, you will understand the reason. There's an English subtitle there too. Everybody recognizes Selena. Laura Canales was another one of the queens of Tejano music before Selena. Patsy Torres is a native of San Antonio. She's still around today performing. Margarita runs a trucking company now, very famous. I didn't want this photo shoot to end at all. I don't know why. The voices of Texas. This is when you bring in some of the heavyweights to do nostalgia and tradition. Vicente Fernandez, he is the Sinatra of ranchero music. And with Jack Daniels, these guys know tradition for sure. What a privilege to work with this man. I've seen this sticker from Hawaii to California to New York. David Lee Garza is a staple. Long staple of music. That's the Grammy he just got several years back, 2 years ago. Oh yeah, by the way, I was his road manager for about 6 months between jobs. These are the famous ones. These are the ones that have grown to have brought in thousands of people from Mexico to the U.S. But what I love working with this gentleman right here, Frank Gomez, very genuine, very charismatic to his music. There's a reason why they call him Big Frank. He's got a big heart, and his music is awesome. Blues, Tejano, a variety. Not your ordinary posters anymore. You got a little bit more depth through the years. Busier is a word too. Freddie Fender, now there's a name to work with. Awesome guy, awesome, awesome guy. Paul Rodriguez, ooh, too many tequila bottles to talk about. You're gonna have Tejano, you gotta have it in Vegas. I don't know who that guy is. Those are the things that I have touched. This was done 2 years ago. Since then, I've been able to work with other people. And I love it, you know. As I attended art school in Houston, my wife now, back then she was my girlfriend, we'd go to a place called Fiesta Mart. The first thing we'd go do is go visit the record side of that store. Because it's a mercado. We'd stay out of the vegetables and stuff, and I'd spend most of my time looking at all the ransom notes that were album covers, and I said, man, there's got to be a better way. When you're inspired by the stuff that Chicago's doing, Blood, Sweat, and Tears, you name it, Asia, all of those guys, you know, you're like, why can't we do it? And the answer is, we don't do it because nobody takes the self-initiative to do it. We can do it. So, I'm going to share something real quick, and then I'm going to move on. While I've been able to work with a lot of people and do some great work, and there's been some duds, and there's been some things up and down, the most important thing is that I wouldn't want to change anything of my life and my history, having worked with these people and learn their vibe, learn their why they do the music the way they do it, you know, for the world. This is their life. This is how they live. And my responsibility is in one window. I have one window to tell a movie. So I do that every single day as best as I can. That's why I spend time not only speaking with them, but being from the music world myself, I always get color from the music. So I'm always asking for advance songs in order to get that vibe out of there first. Today, you're gonna look at history. This is my very first album cover that I ever did in 1983. This is very rough, but yet, this is what set the course. This is the one that gave me the energy to say, you can do it. And the guy who gave me the opportunity is Little Joe from Little Joe La Familia. This one's dedicated to my mom, my dad, and my mom will kill me if she knows I have it. But this is the very first one. Before I graduated, I had a printed piece from art school. And this is my latest piece. So you're talking 1983 to 2017. By the way, this is the best thing that ever happened to Tejano music, at least visually. She's an up-and-coming star. And again, the same process, the same thinking, the same rationale happens. It's all about music. It's not about tattoos, sunglasses, chewing gum, don't you know who I used to be? I'm like, no, I want to know the vibe. I'm sitting here with some gentlemen that understand the vibe. One of them is here, one of my mentors and friends and associates. His name is Henry Petsy Peña. He brought me a project that we started working on to address the baby boomer. The baby boomer gets no love on radio anymore, you know? Or you get these generic oldies out there. We brought it back to what it is. These are original people from San Antonio that actually did their stuff. But you don't do an album just to do it. You have to show where they came from. What were they looking like back in the 70s, you know? Clean them up, make them the best. Tell the story in a quick fashion, but don't miss the details either. The devil is in the detail. This is a 45, and it has to say 45. Why? Because music is more than just an audio thing. It's a visual thing. And when you put them together, it's a beautiful thing. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Check, check, check. Thank you, Ruben.
Do you want to introduce him?
I think you just did. Henry Pepsi Peña right here, San Antonio legend. Get you talking.
Hi there. Thank you.
As I'd like to preface this as we get talking about the music that came out of here. Ruben Molina was not able to join us today from California. He's the author of Chicano Soul, and Texas Tech University Press is getting ready to do a 10th anniversary reprint of it. It's going to be coming out soon. So I have these flyers for Ruben here, and Chris has worked with him and can talk a little bit about the book too. So if you're interested in the Chicano Soul book about the history of San Antonio here in the Chicano Soul scene, please come get a flyer for me. It'll be coming out with TTU Press. Thanks.
Thank you, Chris. Ruben, thank you. Great work. I admire Ruben. I do all my work through him because I believe in what he does and his vision. And a lot of the work that's up here is Ruben's work. I'm going to tell you a little bit about Tejano music. He told you about Tejano music. I'm going to talk about the why. And the why in the music business happened when I was a young kid. You know, as they call me San Antonio's oldest teenager, I'm 140 years old and still in the radio business today. But back when I was a kid in radio, when I was in high school, something unusual happened. Tejano music was growing through the 50s and the 60s. And then here came an album called SG101, Sun Glow 101. There was a young man here in San Antonio by the name of Sonny Ozuna and the Sun Glows. And they were touring, doing the Tejano dances, the Mexican dances, and that kind of thing. But one day he decided he was really a blues singer. He wanted to sing English music, rhythm and blues. But he kept being drawn back by the director of the band, Manny Guerra, from the Sun Glows, because he was already touring Texas with the Tejano industry. So Sonny wrote a song called Golly G, and it got picked up by OK Records, and it went national. And then he did another one called Just a Moment. And then he recorded Talk to Me. And something was happening that nobody really saw, but I call it the why, because the Sun Glows actually split right there, the music scene. And you could actually do Tejano circuit, and then you could do the at that time, rock and roll circuit, which was all the English music and that kind of thing. The album wasn't recorded for that purpose. They took some 45s that were English, some 45s that were Spanish and Tejano. They put it together, and that Sun Glow 101, Talk to Me, is actually 50-50. At that point, Sonny could jump back and forth from the English to Tejano, and it just created a whole new market for him. The teenagers back then, as by nature, were rebellious. We didn't really continue, wanted to be the conjunto music, that Tejano music with mom and dad was listening to. So a lot of the teenagers, musicians here in San Antonio rebelled against that and said, you know, we can do this English music and that kind of thing. So what happened is that I call it West Side Sound. The West Side Sound, what I mean by that is that it's a cultural interpretation of pop, rhythm and blues, doo-wop, and rock and roll. We are not black, we are not blue-eyed soul, we are Hispanic, singing English music with as much soul as we can, and that is called the West Side Sound. From there, groups like Sonny and the Sunliners, Spinoff, the Royal Jesters, Jesse and the Teardrops, Henry and the Casuals, the Lavelles, the Dreamliners, and it just goes on and on and on. At that time, we really didn't have record deals. Everybody's looking for a record deal. We didn't get record deals. So we had to cut our own path. The top 40 stations wouldn't play our music because it wasn't good enough, or they thought it wasn't national enough. The Mexican stations wouldn't play Sonny's Tejano music because it wasn't Spanish enough. So here we are in a lane all by ourselves. So we created our own lane. We created our own record companies, our own distribution, our own recording studios. We went out and got it done. And today, 2017, you got music on that A.B. Epstein recorded here in town. You can find those 45s. If you can find them, they're going for $400, $500, $600, $800 a piece. That's what happened back in the 50s and 60s. I call it the West Side Sound. And what I've done is I'm the promoter of these events that are up here here in San Antonio. And I took those artists, brought them back, and put them in a huge venue, one of the top number one rated venue in town, the Tobin Center. Opened the doors, and I woke up a sleeping giant. They're called the baby boomers. They said, I remember that when I was a teenager. I remember us going to the dances, the sock hops. I'd like to do it all over again. And they came out in droves. They came out to see Sonny and also Rudy T. Gonzalez, Archie Bell, Jimmy Charles, Ernie Garavai. All these people were there at my first Patio in the Luz, and it was just phenomenal. Did another one this year. Had Barbara Lynn there, Mr. Monroe from the Platters. Monroe Powell was there from the Platters, and of course some of the local artists, and again had a huge crowd. We continue to do that. I've got a radio show. I was in radio in high school, and I'm back in radio again on 24 syndicated radio stations throughout the country. It's called the SA Oldies Radio Show, saoldies.com on 24/7, and we play the homegrown hits from San Antonio, and we play the national hits, kind of mix them together, talk about history and content, and the show has just taken off, and the baby boomer from 50 on and 45 on, they just can't get enough of this music, can't get enough of the San Antonio West Side sound. So that's what I have dedicated myself here to lately. It's been a huge success with the help of Ruben and people like Ray and everybody else. So that's kind of what happened here in San Antonio and still happening today. Thank you.
If it's okay, we'll just hold questions till the end. We'll get everybody to speak, and then if you got questions, I can run around the room.
Good morning. My name is Ray Cabello. I was born and raised here in San Antonio. Particularly in the big neighborhood that Henry was talking about, which is the West Side, which is in the West Side of the city. I went to Tafoya, Lanier, a lot of these guys went to school. Same school that Roe Justice went to, I went to. And around 17 years ago, I inherited a huge collection from my grandfather. It was about 3,000 records. Had no clue what it was. I was really into hip hop at the time, and not interested in Spanish music. At the time, I mean, truthfully, that's what it was. You know, I was not interested in Spanish music. You know, I was really into rap, and I was really into basketball. And so one day I'm kind of sorting through all these records, and then I realized that they're all from San Antonio. And my uncle used to produce a lot of records, so we're kind of sitting down here and looking through these records and realizing as we're looking them up that they're heavily sought after records. And so I pretty much from then on was just collecting 45s, strictly 45s. I could not care less about LPs. I just wanted San Antonio English 45s. And then around 2007, I met a gentleman by the name of Rob Sevier. He co-founded the label Numero Group out of Chicago, Illinois. They're a four-time Grammy nominated label. And we were going back and forth on, you know, what kind of San Antonio stuff that you have. And he ended up flying down here, ended up staying for a long time on my couch, just going through records. And then he mentioned another gentleman by the name of Chris Varelas. And we ended up linking up with him. Went to his beautiful house, saw his collection. And from that point on, we've been archiving music out of San Antonio. We've done about four releases since then. They've done really, really well. And it's important to note that this sound is heavily sought after right now by everywhere. And it's also important to know that at the time, if correct me if I'm wrong, Henry, they were honestly trying to mimic black music. And because of who they were and their heritage, there's just no way that they could do that and ended up sounding like their own, which is Chicano soul. And it's a mixture of, as he said, you know, rock, pop, blues, conjunto, all those fused into one pot, and then you have Chicano soul. And it's heavily driven by horns, organ, really raw guitar. You can hear it in the recordings. I mean, sorry, but the guitar is like out of tune, but that's why it sounds amazing. Like, seriously, you know, I was talking to Danny from Danny and the Dreamers, and he was really, really upset that I wanted to use Eternal Love for the recording. He's like, that was the first song I learned how to play. And I was like, it's out of tune, and that's why I want it on the record. It's pretty amazing. You can't get that raw recording anywhere, especially with music nowadays. People kind of record with their eyes. They see that click and making sure it's landing on the click. Back then, it was just takes. Play it, record it, press it. And people like A.B. Epstein were producing just tons and tons of titles. It's every time I think I have a good collection of, okay, here's a strong set of about, you know, 40 labels that he did, someone pops up and it's like, where did this Plum Records come from? Who is this artist? And so my job is to make sure to capture all that history, document it, remaster it, put it out into the world, and make sure that guys like Henry, Ruben, their work is getting crafted and recognized. And hopefully with Chris and other people, you guys are looking into those titles, liking them, and we can keep producing them out. Thank you.
I'm gonna stand up, it makes it a little easier. I feel like I'm in college sitting down talking to the professor. Little background. I'm a full-blooded Greek from Greek immigrants. You may say, why are you involved in this music? Well, at about 15 years old, I became a top 40 DJ, singing in a curse. anybody that spent any time in radio will tell you that. It's a double-edged sword, but I enjoyed the, let me go full screen down here.
Any free tickets?
Yeah, a lot of free tickets, and the thing that was most interesting was within about a month or two of playing Top 40 in San Antonio, we were receiving a lot of phone calls from people wanting to hear groups that, even though I considered myself fluent on Top 40 and what was played nationally, I was hearing a lot of names that I'd never heard before. I was born in the mid-60s. So people were calling asking about, can you play Sonny? Like, Sonny who? Can you, you know, that's, you know, I'm 15 years old and was born in the mid-60s. This stuff happened before I was born. And the Royal Jesters and the Commands. And these calls were coming so frequently that I knew that there was something that had happened here at one point, musically, that left its mark on a lot of people. And what that was a local music scene that if you went outside of San Antonio, you didn't know anything about it. For the most part, this stuff stayed in-house. And I realized that something special occurred here in San Antonio, musically, and I wanted to find out more about it. So in digging, I found that it basically went back to three record producers that were in charge of a ton of labels. This fellow on the left, of course, Henry knows him much longer than I've known him. And passed away about 3 years ago, but that's A.B. Epstein. And here's a guy in 1959, recorded one of the greatest rockabilly records for a guy by the name of Lonnie Fairbanks here in town, had a small label called Wildcat Records. On the flip side was a great, smooth doo-wop ballad, but it's the only record he did. And then he went into the record business. Fell on the right, about the same time, 1959, that's Manny Guerra. Henry mentioned him earlier. These guys are the cornerstones, along with Emil Hinke, to a lesser extent, because he didn't do the volume that these guys did. But let me tell you, these two fellas right here are responsible for over 2,000 single songs here in San Antonio. That's a lot. And this fellow on the left had about seven or eight labels with 900 releases, and the fellow on the right had countless labels that I haven't even exhausted the list of. It's pretty extensive. But the more you dug, the more you realized that these two guys, they were the forefathers of this soul sound, this San Antonio West Side sound. Of course, there were other smaller players in the game. But for the most part, these two guys did it. Back in the 60s in San Antonio, mom and pop radio and mom and pop record stores ruled. Henry will tell you the same thing. If you had an in at a for a disc jockey, you probably were going to get airplay. And if you got airplay, the mom and pop record stores were going to be selling your records. A Platter Palace, Del Bravo, Janie's, all these places, they were going to be selling your records if you got played on the big stations. So a relationship with these local DJs was paramount to your success. But these guys here, they ran the show in the 60s. They did so many things. The sad part of it is, fell on the left, A.B. Epstein. And I look to Henry because he knows this stuff better than I do, but I'm telling you, this guy had the opportunity to create at least three local groups into worldwide household names, and it didn't happen. And it didn't happen for a multitude of reasons. One of the biggest ones was a lot of these acts, for I think financial reasons, and also because he recruited them from local talent shows, he felt like they were his baby, the Commands. He did not want to farm these guys out to Atlantic, Epic. Now, Renee and Renee was the exception. They wind up going to Columbia. But I don't think that was, you know, AB's doings. I think they did it on their own. But they broke into a national label. Renee and Renee was the exception. But he dug those guys up. You got these two guys, you know, from Laredo, and they wind up having national hits. But they didn't have them with AB. They had them with major labels. But he had other groups with even more talent. The Royal Jesters, the Commands. The Commands were a phenomenal group. So good, one of their local singles here, according to AB's records, sold in excess of 160,000 copies. No Time for You, in 1966. To put that in perspective, Jan and Dean had a number one hit in 63, Surf City, and it didn't even sell 200,000 copies in LA, and it hit number one nationally. That just shows you how strong this local record was. If you could sell that many copies in San Antonio, just think how many you could have sold in LA, Detroit, Houston, New York, Chicago. But he didn't let these guys bust out of this city. And if they would have been, they would have become household names. So much so that a group called the OJs that everybody's heard of, they actually copied one of the Command songs and released it on Imperial, and it charted on the R&B charts. But the Commands should have had national hits. The Royal Jesters should have had national hits. And again, for a multitude of reasons, a part of it probably because he raised these guys up from pups, recruiting them from talent shows, meeting them at schools, and he just decided, you know what? I want to keep these guys to myself. And he told me one time, he said, why would I want to make a penny for every record they sell when I can have them on my own label and make a quarter? So put the math together, and he was like, you know what? If he can sell a lot locally, why farm it to a big label where he's just going to be getting pennies on the sales? But these guys were important. The Commands, the group that I mentioned of, here are these guys. This is a picture that probably nobody has seen. Everybody's seen their picture sleeve covers. These are guys. Jack Martinez at the bottom. You got Emmanuel Grace, Dan Henderson, and Sam Peoples. The only one alive is the fellow at the bottom, Jack Martinez. And he loved this music. He loved singing. And he even attested himself when he did an interview with us last year that they should have been a national act. that they were basically kept, but they didn't know any better. Just like any other groups back then, these are young guys, they were military guys, they were at an Air Force base here in San Antonio, they won a talent show, A.B. Epstein saw that they won, followed them around and wind up signing them. But these guys should have been as big as the Spinners, the OJs, and so many other groups that became, you know, household names. Here's another picture of them, the pitcher sleeve. Look at the gloves. Look at how the arms, I mean, this was a class act. These were military Air Force Base guys here in San Antonio. They won a local talent show, they went to a regional, and ultimately they won a national talent show in Los Angeles for all military groups across the country. And here these guys are, new into the Air Force, and traveling on an Air Force jet around the country performing, and they did that. And then A.B. Epstein found out and signed them up. But these guys were phenomenal. The fellow on the right on the producers we showed earlier, Manny Guerra, he produced these guys. Again, I think even though they did have national hits, they, you know, Sonny covered Little Willie John's mid-50s song, Talk to Me, and it became a pretty big hit nationally. But these guys should have been much bigger than they were, and a lot of it had to do with being on labels. I mean, granted, OK and London were significant labels, but they didn't have the distribution network that some of the big ones had, like Capitol, Epic, Decca. Here's another Sunglows picture. These guys, again, these were local guys, Burbank High School here in San Antonio, legends. Absolute legends. These were the groups that these people were calling me when I was 15 years old on the radio, asking me to play, and I'm like, I never heard of them. And I soon found out that these guys were bigger in one sense, and Henry again will tell you, they were bigger than people of the same era that were national hits, because these guys, people knew them. They could touch them. They could go to concerts. They could see them out there. Here's a picture again, a local group. These guys were produced by Emil Hinke, one of the other legendary record producers here. Demas Garza, also after this picture, years later, a member of the World Jesters and a solo artist in his own right. It's a great picture. This is a high school picture. This was a seniors in high school. Look at these shoes, spectator shoes. These guys don't look, this looks like a New York doo-wop group. But this was a Lanier High School senior talent show pitcher. And it's a phenomenal pitcher. Demas Garza gave this to me years ago. And he's like, nobody's seen this pitcher. He says, one that was taken at a talent show. And, but these were guys that were local legends here. They performed locally. They got played on the radio ad nauseum. I mean, some of these songs were played bigger than number one hits were played here in San Antonio. I want to give you a little taste of one of the songs by the Commands. See if we can get this thing to play here. It's an example of something that probably should have been a number one hit nationally. See if we can get this thing to play. Curtis, I may need your help on this.
Ad lib, sing it to us.
You know, if I was anywhere close to these guys' talent, I'd probably give it a whiz. See if.
Where did it go?
You have to go back one. Hit the play thing here.
Yeah, it did.
Oh, you did me wrong.
Anyways, that's a taste of one of the great local hits here in San Antonio that never made the national charts. And I'm going to close by just adding, like Henry, both radio backgrounds. I was fortunate enough to be able to retire when I turned 50 years old. Not a good thing unless you have something to fill the void. You need to have something to do. And fortunately, I was able to get an FM radio station here in San Antonio. So we're at 97.9 on the FM, not here to promote my station by any stretch, but I am here to promote these groups. And these particular groups, we play a lot. We play 8 to 10 local, non-charted releases every hour, 24/7. We've been on the air about a year. We're 97.9 on the FM, KCJV, which is my initials, which I thought, you know, 12,000 radio stations in the United States, my initials were actually available. So I was like, what the hell are the odds of that? I mean, there's every, but so I dedicated that radio station to all these local acts. I mean, even Henry, I don't know if he knows this, but his band is, we've probably played 14 of their songs. We play over 45 Sonny and the Sunliners songs, over 30 Royal Jester songs. So we have a radio station that emphasizes local artists. We play 1,700 songs from San Antonio from 1955 to 1975. So a lot of people say, you know, could you have done something else or could you have more listeners if you played, you know, rap? Yeah, I could, you know, but we wanted to play local artists, and I know it's a niche market. We appeal to a small thing, but my wife will tell you this. This has been the craziest 13 months since we went on the air because we discovered one thing. Out of 2,200 plus emails we've gotten since we've been on the air and thousands of phone calls, the craziest thing that we discovered is that our average listener is between 20 and 30 years old. That's the shocker. I wouldn't have believed it in a million years. And I thought, where's this demo that we were targeting? Why are we not hitting that? And who are these young people that are listening? And it's phenomenal. And I every morning when I wake up, there'll be 6, 8, 10, 12 emails that I answer. And it's all young people. I ask them, how did you find out about the station? I just happened to be tuning. A friend mentioned it. Facebook, YouTube, you name it. But the fact that we're connecting with a young audience, I think it's long term. I think that's the key to the survival and the appreciation of this type of music. And I know books like the one that Ruben Molina released is important, but you gotta connect it with the music, and that's where radio comes in. And I really think that something big is going on here. I really can't put my finger on it. Austin Record Show occurred last week. Thousands of people at this record show in Austin, largest music event in the United States. Tons of young people buying vinyl, tons of them, and record booths where people are buying medium to high-end record players. So there is something going on with this music. There is an appreciation of young people. I think the greatest thing that music being not good the past 15, 20 years has done is it's forced young it's forced people to listen to something else. And I thought, you know, I never thought I'd have appreciation for rap. Well, I do, because it caused people that don't like it to look other ways. But anyways, I appreciate you guys listening. Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you, Chris.
Henry would like to add one thing.
Yeah, I wanted to mention one thing. A.B. Epstein was my friend. I knew him since I was in high school, before I graduated from high school. I was a mentor. Went to lunch and dinner many, many, many times. I recorded at his recording studio. I was there many nights until the wee hours of the night until he finished the session. Then we'd go to Mi Tierra and go get something to eat. But let me tell you about how creative AB was. Back then, there was no mass media. There was no Facebook, anything like that. So what AB would do, he would call he would call New York, the subway. And he says, you know, Henry, at any given time in Grand Central Station, there's a million people. So he'd pick up the phone at night and he'd say, could you page Renee and Renee, please? So they'd page Renee and Renee, in Grand Central Station, everybody would hear it at one time. Paging Renee and Renee, paging Renee and Renee. He'd call LAX, middle of the night. Would you please page Renee and Renee? Paging Renee and Renee, paging Renee. So he got the name out there one way or another. That's AB. A little bit about Manny Guerra, a friend of mine for many years when I was in radio in high school. One of my friends still, I call him from time to time. Everybody talked about the sound that came out of his studio on South Flores. And if you drove by his studio, you'd miss it. It just looked like an old haunted house. And you walk in the studio and there was carpet remnants nailed to the wall for the sound effects. Then the ceiling, I mean, it was like a whole room full of different colors, carpets and that thing. And I said, where do you get this echo? He says, well, come on back here. So I went into the backyard of this house, and there was this huge empty fuel tank sitting there in the backyard. And he had one microphone on one side and a speaker on the other side, and that's how he got his echo. He says, the only thing, Henry, at night when the dog barks at my next door neighbor, we have to stop recording. Anyway, go ahead.
All right. Next up, we got Benny from El Paso. Thank you guys for the just an introduction to San Antonio there. So we've got Benny from El Paso kind of talk about what's going on over there, which is very connected. I think it's very similar to what's happened in San Antonio. So turn it over.
Good morning. My name's Benny Bustillos. I'm originally from El Paso. I started this project, I say, 5 years ago. And my biggest inspiration came from growing up listening to a DJ. His name was Steve Krosno. He was a big DJ. Maybe you heard of him. Very big in El Paso. He had this mystique about him, you know. And he wasn't even Mexican, but he definitely wanted to be Mexican. You know what I mean? And I just remember growing up and listening to all these oldies on the radio, you know, and always wondering what those people went through and what was their struggle and how was it back then, you know, being Chicano, being from the barrio. You know, El Paso was predominantly Latino, but of course, you know, there was people with money that controlled the radio stations and controlled the music. So I wanted to dig deeper and find those stories out because I had an uncle. He founded his own jazz station. And growing up, I saw him do radio and advertising and stuff like that. And, you know, this is just my little dedication to my hometown. I want to show my people that they're not forgotten, the struggles they went through. I'm here to tell their story. So I just want to show you guys a rough edit, and you guys can check this out.
Our first gig, it was in Our Lady Youth Center. We played 2 hours and we got 50 cents each. Then I got three dances that they heard us play there, that they want us to play in La Quinceañera of certain gangs, you know, certain gangs. But in order to get to that place, play for that gang, these guys had to let us go in. And since we were in Park, over there by 12th and 13th Street, we had to cross about at least 9 gangs. But we was okay because we were gonna play there for the 13th. And the guy said, look, I know where you're from, man. And I'll open for you to come here. As soon as you finish playing, you got 15 minutes to load up and leave. Man, to set up and put the drums and guitars and everything, saxophones, everything in the van, get them out of there. We still get some beer thrown on, rocks and knives hitting the windshield. And we just drove, man. And we got there. How much we gonna get everybody? 75 cents each.
What? 75 cents. Okay, that sounds good.
Yeah. But the worst one that I had to go in the Chihuahuita, man, and Chihuahua. Now that, I you have to go through Los Ciertos, Los Nueves, the Chihuahuita, man.
And this is all in Segundo Barrio, right?
That's all Segundo Barrio.
El Paso.
Yeah. But since I couldn't read, when they taught me how to read music, well, they would show me a chart and a little stick with a black stuff, and it says, that's a quarter note. Wow, I can read that. And this is a half a note. And this is a whole note. Oh, I can read that. So, finally, they would put music in there, so I would, hey, I've got the beat, so I'd play the music. From 7th grade, I went to beginner's band at 3 months. One of the B-band teachers, no, first of all, in those 3 months, there were clarinet challenges. In those 3 months, I was already first year.
Joe Stevens, who was a promoter in El Paso. And what he used to do was book a lot of groups that would come into town, concerts at the Coliseum. And one time he approached us, we were still fairly green, and he approached us to see if we would be interested in actually performing and opening up a couple of shows for Sunny and the Sunliners.
Yeah, they did it within a day.
I think you remember that. And so we did. We did a couple of shows, and after a while, Joe started becoming a fan of the music.
That's Steve.
And then he said that
that's me.
That's he wanted us to open up for a little show in La Papilla, so we opened up for them. On that day, he sat us in the back, and then he said, "I've got a guy up in San Antonio that's looking for groups, and I told him to go ahead and record you guys." And he said okay, but that he had never recorded a group without having heard him first. So he actually set up the studio session in Corpus Christi and had us meet him there without ever hearing one single of the song, how we played or anything like that. That was the first time they'd ever done something like that. And we thought that was the normal process of doing the recording. So we drove all the way to Corpus Christi, we got there, and we started playing their songs, and lucky for us, the producer, Chester Foyley was his name, was actually very excited with the music he was hearing. The reason was it was a little bit different than what the Tejano sound was in San Antonio and a couple of the cities down in Brownsville and a couple of the other ones, was that the Mexican music or the Tejano music in El Paso, for whatever reason, was played at a faster pace. It was almost literally, you couldn't go any faster. Where the Tejano had more of this kind of a feel, we were more, this one. And so it was a new thing for him. So he said, well, I've got something new going on here. So he did the whole album. We came back, learned a lot while we were in those sessions through those guys and everything else. I mean, I remember they were actually tuning the drums. They were actually tuning the bass, tuning the guitars to recording perfection, because in those days, we weren't doing that. I mean, we would actually go off with a trumpet, which Barney had, to try to tune ourselves all into that same tuning, which was the weirdest instrument to tune off of, not because he didn't have it played well, but because to try to get intonations that are string tight to actually match up with the horn is like kind of really difficult. So there was a learning curve, a learning process, even in the singing part of it. I mean, I had to take a lot of takes, had to get used to how to do that kind of stuff, how to double the tracks and so on. So a lot of process that was done that way. So by our first album, we were actually very green. We came back with a little bit more of a comfort level doing that. And the album was released, and we were talking about Steve Crossnow. He's the first one to approach us to tell us that he wanted to release one of the songs off of the album. Now,
when I came to the group, my brother was already in there. and the people that actually originated the group, that started the group, were Danny and Joe Padilla. And then I came in, they invited me to come, and I joined, and it was a good thing, you know. We used to practice at Boys Club, remember, Lord?
Mm-hmm.
Boys Club on Southside. And then we moved our practice session to my house. And then we spent there the rest of the time there. So they were like my children. You know, they were like my children, everybody. And it was actually the highlight of, in my life, you know. I see that these guys were great, good. I'm from the barrio, mostly from Bowie High School. We had one from El Paso High, one from Coronado, and let's see, but it's the only ones I can remember now.
And then when I joined the group, and my brother, by then we were practicing at the Boys Club, and we were predominantly Bowie High School, Segundo Barrio. And from there, you know, it developed into what I thought was probably a very sophisticated group, you know, because we were, was really important for us to get the right sound. And we were very blessed to have a great singer in Marty. Because Marty was the highlight of the group. She had a beautiful voice, beautiful personality. And so from there, you know, we became, I guess, one of the well-known groups in El Paso, late 60s, early 70s. Like my brother said, it was kind of a highlight in our lives, an experience that will stay with us the rest of our lives. Good memories, good friends. Because some of those guys in the band we've been friends for all these years. It's almost 50 years that I was playing with them. And so I kind of wish we had recorded more, because we had some really nice arrangements and songs that, but we didn't. It took money. Either we didn't have it or we didn't want to invest in it. But I wish we had recorded more, because that would have been something that would have been awesome. But we didn't. And so the memories that we have are in our hearts and in our minds. And
The 19th, and I was 17. I hit Segundo. I decided to become a singer, and I got the guys together, and I got me about four or five guys, and we started finding other guys that could play with.
Yeah.
Some of us went to school together, some of us just hung around with buddies. And we started. I had my cousin, Robert Coleman, we call him Junior, and my other cousin, Billy. We were the only three blacks, you know. And that's the guys, you know, that were with me with the picture, the poster picture.
Mm-hmm.
So it was pretty nice.
That's nice, man.
We became an 18-piece band later on. We were a big band, man. Big band.
So.
Go ahead.
I apologize for the rough edit, but I'm still in the process. I'll be going at it for another year, two, if I have to. You know, sometimes it takes a while to find some of these people. Some of them, they struggled so much, they don't want to talk about their past. So it's always a constant battle trying to get them on camera and feeling comfortable. But hopefully I can finish, and maybe one day you guys will come back and see it or something. Thank you.
I know we're up against the time here, but I want to thank everybody. If anybody's got any questions, feel free to come on up during the break right now, and let's visit here up here by the stage. If you feel like, if you got some questions, please come on up.